Okay, let's start this review with number two. It says, determine if the sequence is arithmetic, and if it is, find the term named in the problem and the explicit formula. So first, I need to make sure that you remember the formulas. The explicit formula is x sub n equals x sub 1 plus the common difference times n minus 1. Where, like I said, this is the first term. This is how much we're adding or subtracting every time. And this is the number of terms. So it's saying if I want the 12th term, then that would be a 12 right there. Okay. And then this problem right here, I go 24 to 21, 21 to 18, 18 to 15. And in each of those, I am going down by 3. I'm subtracting 3. And it's the same amount. And I would go ahead and check all of them just to make sure it follows the pattern. And so what I need to do is, I'll do that in a second, I need to find the explicit formula, a sub n or x sub n, doesn't really matter, equals the first term, 24, plus the common difference, so I could put plus a negative 3, or I can just say minus 3, times n minus 1. Okay, and that is my explicit formula. And guys, on the test, I want the formula in general, and then I want the 22nd term. So that, I'm okay with us actually just typing in. I don't need to see where you filled in 22. If you want to, you can, but you don't have to. 24 minus 3 times 22 minus 1, or 21. I do not suggest that you do this piece by piece because you're liable to make a mistake somewhere. So, anyway, the answer is negative 39. Okay. On number 4. I see that I am going from negative 7 to negative 5, which means I am adding 2. But then I go from negative 5 to negative 3, which means I added 3. And I don't have to keep going to know that now this is not arithmetic. And so I'm done. But you do have to state it's not arithmetic. Otherwise, I just think you didn't do it. Okay. Number 6 says find the recursive formula on the next 3 terms in the sequence. So, I need to figure out, well first let me write down the recursive formula. The recursive formula is x sub n equals x sub n minus 1 plus the common difference, and then we have to state the first term. So this formula, unlike the explicit formula, so the explicit formula includes both the first term and the common difference in their expression, because you can literally find any term by just plugging in the common difference in the first term. This is just telling you what the sequence is doing. Any term, like the 50th term, is the 49th term plus the common difference, and then starting here. The only thing you're filling in is the common difference and the first term. Okay? So, for this problem, I know that I am, let's see, I am adding 2 each time. And so I just put x sub n equals x sub n minus 1 plus 2. And if this is level with your plus 2, I will cut off. This is a subscript, and that's not, okay? And then x sub 1 is my first term, negative 37. And it also asks for the next 3 terms, so I just keep adding 2. So negative 29, negative 27, and negative 25. And there you go. Number 8 says, given the explicit formula for an arithmetic sequence, find the recursive formula. So it's just a matter of reading the problem for what it wants. So I asked you guys to fix that to be n minus 1. Okay. So what this tells me is that the first term, x sub 1 or a sub 1 is that, and that the common difference is 6. So, the recursive formula is a sub n equals a sub n minus 1 plus the common difference, so minus 6, and then you state the first term, which is 38, and you're done. So it's just a matter of filling out the formula. Number 10 says, given the recursive formula, find the explicit formula, so just going backwards. So, x sub n equals x sub 1 plus the common difference times n minus 1. So every time you fill in the formula, there's only 2 things you got to fill in, the first term and the common difference. So the first term is negative 39, and the common difference is 2. And I'm done. Okay, So switching gears, moving into inverse functions. So inverse functions are where I give you a linear function and I want you to find the inverse function, which basically is the function that that does every operation in the exact opposite order of the other one. And when you graph them, they are reflections across a specific line, which we'll explore in just a second. But first, let's just talk about finding the inverse. Okay, so this right here is the same thing as saying y equals. All right. Well, the idea behind inverse is that the x's and the y's switch every single point. The x's and the y's switch. So in the equation, we actually switch the x's and the y's. I'm writing it down twice because depending on your level of comfort with fractions, I'm going to work it a couple different ways. Okay. So the idea now, after you switch the x and the y, is to solve for y. So right now I'm multiplying by 7/4, and I'm adding 2, so I'm going to subtract 2. And say x minus 2 equals a negative 7 over 4y. And then I'm going to undo these things that are in front of the y. Do you agree? Like, you're going to answer my question. Negative 7 is being multiplied by y, and 4 is being divided. So what I want to do is undo the division first. So I'm going to multiply by 4. But when you multiply by 4, you have to remember that you're multiplying both sides of the equation. So over here, it's no big deal. It's just one term, and they simplify out. But here, you've got to remember that you're distributing. So this is actually 4x minus 8 equals a negative 7y. And then now you're multiplying by a negative 7, and you want to undo that operation, so we divide by a negative 7. Okay? Now, a 4 divided by negative 7 is just a negative 4/7. And a negative divided by negative is a positive, and 8 does not divide by 7, so 8/7 equals y inverse. So don't forget your inverse notation. Or you could say f inverse of x. Okay. The other option is when you work it, you again subtract the 2. But if you'll notice over here, and some of you probably already did this, we multiplied by 4 and we divided by negative 7. Let's just do that same thing at the same time. We multiplied by 4 and divided by a negative 7. Now, dividing by a negative is the same thing as just being negative, so if you're a positive. So let's just multiply by the reciprocal of whatever that fraction is. A negative 7/4 and a negative 4/7. It had been a positive 7/4, it had been a positive 4/7. And we got to do that to both sides, so a negative 4 over 7. So here's the idea. 7 divided by 7 is 1, 4 divided by 4 is 1, and the negative times the negative is positive. So I have gotten y by itself already. And then I have to remember to distribute. So negative 4/7 times x is a negative 4/7 x, and a negative 4/7 times a negative 2 is a positive 8/7. And there you go. Either way, you got the same thing. I think on my key that I put on the board, I added the 2 over, so that was a minus, but it's supposed to be a plus. Whoops. Alright, number 14. We need to find the inverse of the function, graph the function, and its inverse. So the first thing I'm going to do is talk about graphing this. H of x. It's really easy to graph a function, a linear function, when it looks like y equals mx plus b, where I can see the slope and I can see the y-intercept. But in this case, I've got negative x minus 5 all divided by 2. So in order to graph, you really need to split up the function. You need to say negative 1 over 2x minus 5 over 2. So basically, go ahead and divide each term by 2. Okay? So if I go ahead and plot that, my y-intercept is a negative 5 halves. 5 cut in half is 2 and a half, so I'm going to go down to negative 2.5 and plot a point. And then my slope is negative 1 half, so that means I'm going to go down 1 and over 2. Down 1 and over 2. Down 1 and over 2. To the right 2, I should say. Or up 1 and to the left 2. As long as one of your directions is negative, then you've got a negative slope. If both of your directions are negative, negative and down and left, then you've got a positive slope. Up 1 and over 2. And then we connect. I just went below every point. Okay, whatever. Alright, so then I need to find the inverse. Okay, I'm going to work it from both ways because it really doesn't matter. One, I'm going to work it from here. Y equals negative x minus 5 divided by 2. And the other one, I'm going to work from here. Y equals a negative 1 half x minus 5 over 2. So whichever one you prefer. Doesn't really matter. They're the same equation. So to find the inverse, we switch x and y. X equals a negative y minus 5 divided by 2. Okay, right now, y is being multiplied by a negative 1. I am subtracting 5 and dividing by 2. So if you notice, the last thing I said is dividing by 2, because I was like, if I plugged in a 10 right here, what would I do? Multiply by negative, then I would subtract 5, then I would divide by 2. So dividing by 2 is the first thing you need to get rid of. So you multiply by 2, because we're dividing. Those simplify out. So I'm left with 2x equals a negative 1y minus 5, or just negative y. And then I'm going to add 5 to both sides. So 2x plus 5 equals a negative 1y, or negative y. And I need to solve for y. So I undo the multiplication by a negative, by dividing by a negative. Or, I mean, you're getting to the point in your mathematical career that you know what happens when you divide by negative. You just change all the signs. But that is what we're doing. We're dividing by a negative 1. And it becomes a negative 2x minus 5 equals y inverse. Okay, so let's show that we get the same thing over here. We switch x and y. And we add the 5 halves. And then we multiply by a negative 2 over 1. The reciprocal of whatever that is. So negative 2 over 1, or just negative 2, because that is what it is. Okay? And then we get negative 2x, because a negative 2 times x, and then a negative 2 times 5 over 2, and negative 2 times 5 over 2, you can look at it two different ways. You can look at it as, top times top, bottom times bottom, so that would be a negative 10 divided by 2, which is a negative 5, or you can think, well, 2 divided by 2 is 1, so it's just a negative 1 times 5, which is negative 5. So we get minus 5 equals y inverse. So either way, we got the same inverse. Okay? My y-intercept is negative 5. And my slope is negative 2, which means negative 2 over 1. Go down 2 into the right 1. Or go up 2 into the left 1. Okay. So once I sketch these, the way to test your answer is knowing that it should be a reflection across y equals x. And like I ask you to like turn your paper to where this is like your line of sight. And then do these reflect across each other? And if you folded the paper along that line, would they in fact land on each other? And they do, so I know that I'm correct. If you're taking the test and they don't, then you know something is wrong. Okay? Alright. Alright, number 16. So number 16 starts the systems. So let's go ahead and get going on that. 1, 2, 3. Please do label your rows. And while we're working, tell me what you're doing in each step so I don't have to guess. That would be very nice. Okay, so number 16. I'm actually going to work it two different ways, so that might make this video a little long. So if you don't need it, or if you only need to see it one way, then you can just move on after this, okay? So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to decide what I want to target. And I see that this is really nice because this is a 1. And I noticed that, like, if I just multiplied this by a 2, then I would have a negative 2, but that's a negative 2, so if I multiplied it by a negative 2, then I would have a positive 2. And this is a 4 and a 2, I could just multiply this by a negative 2 and get a positive 4, and if I multiply this by a negative 4, I could get a positive 4. Either way, what I don't like is that they're all negative, so if I was going to target x's, I'm going to rewrite it real quick so I can show you what I would do. You don't have to, but it's just something to think about. Uh, If I'm targeting X's and all of them are negative and I know I'm going to use row one for both of them, then I would just change all the signs on this. I would make that a positive, make that a negative, make that a positive, make that a negative. And then I don't have to worry about it. So, I know a lot of you aren't going to do that, or you didn't think to do that right away. So I'll just go ahead and leave it as is. But as a strategy, it's a very good one because you don't have to worry about the negative. Okay, so I'm going to target X's. All right. I want to use row one and row two. So I know row two is a negative two, which means I need row one to be a positive two. So I'm going to multiply row 1 by a negative 2, because a negative 2 times a negative 1 is a positive 2, and I'm going to add row 2. This is what I mean by telling me what you're doing. You're targeting x's, and this is what you're going to do. So I'm going to multiply row 1 by a negative 2. So negative 1 times negative 2 is a positive 2. 4 times negative 2 is a negative 8y. Negative 4 times negative 2 is a positive 8. And negative 2 times 5 is a negative 10. And then I write down row 2, I'll just keep it, negative 2x minus 1y plus 4z equals a negative 8, and then I add. Okay, so these two simplify out. Negative 8 plus a negative 1 is a negative 9. 8 plus 4 is 12. And negative 10 and negative 8 is a negative 18. Okay, again, test-taking strategy. I see that 9, 12, and 18 are all multiples of 3. So if I could divide out a 3 right now, a negative 3y plus 4z equals a negative 6, that's a much simpler set of numbers to deal with. So if you think about doing it, it makes your problem a lot easier. Okay, so I eliminated x's once. I need to eliminate them again. So I'm going to use row 1 and row 3. And I'm going to make this a positive 4. And then so that'll cancel out with that one. So I'm going to multiply a negative 1 times a negative 4. So that's row 1 times negative 4 plus row 3. Okay, so negative 1 times negative 4 is a positive 4x. Negative 4 times a positive 4 is a negative 16. Negative 4 times a negative 4 is a positive 16. I can't say positive there, it's a negative. And then negative 4 times 5 is a negative 20, and then I just write down row 3. Negative 4x minus 1y minus 3z equals 15. And then I add. Okay. So, those simplify out. Negative 1 minus, or negative 16 minus 1 is a negative 17. 16 minus 3 is 13. And negative 20 plus 5 is negative 5. Now, these are just rude numbers, which is why it would be even nicer if I were to think about using the smaller numbers, because then I would have to multiply by so much. But I'm assuming that not everyone is going to think to divide, so I'm just going to go ahead and use that one, okay? So now the idea is that we've eliminated one variable, and now I've got two equations, a negative 9y plus a 12z equals a negative 18. And I've got a negative 17y plus 13z equals a negative 5. And I want to eliminate a variable again, because now I've only got two. Okay. They're equally ugly, so I'm just going to go ahead and pick the z. I'm going to multiply this by a 13. And I'm going to multiply this by a negative 12. So I've got 12 times 13 here and negative 12 times 13 there. They will cancel each other out. Okay, so we distribute a 13. Times negative 9 is a negative 117. So negative 117y, 13 times 12 is 156, plus 156z equals 13 times a negative 18 is a negative 234. Okay, and depending on where you put the negative, I put the negative with a 12, but depending on where you put the negative, your signs might be the exact opposite, and that's okay, because it'll work out. And then I multiply the negative 12, so negative 12 times negative 17 is 204. And then negative 12 times 13 is a negative 156. And a negative 12 times a negative 5 is 60. And then we add. So negative 117 plus 204 is 87y. These two simplify out, and I've got negative 234 plus 60 is a negative 174. And then to solve, I divide by 87 and hope that I get 2. Negative 174 divided by 87, and I get negative 2. Okay, so that is the beginning of the end. Once I've got one variable, then I can go and start plugging in and solving for the rest. So I've got y equals a negative 2, so then I choose one of these equations to solve for z, because I've got an equation involving just y and z. I'll go ahead and use the top one. Negative 9 times y, which is negative 2, plus 12z equals a negative 18. Negative 9 times negative 2 is a positive 18, so if I subtract 18, I've got a negative 36, so z equals a negative 3, because I divide by 12. And now that I've got z and I've got y, then I can go back to the very top and use one of those equations and solve for x. So I'll go ahead and use the top equation. So okay, so in the top equation I've got negative x plus 4 times y, which is negative 2, minus 4 times z, which is negative 3, equals 5. And then I just solve from there. Okay, that is a negative 8. That is a positive 12. Negative 8 plus 12 is 4. Negative x plus 4 equals 5. I subtract 4 over negative x equals 1. X equals a negative 1. So my answer should be negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. And that, thankfully, is correct. Okay, but I said I was going to work it two different ways, right? So now I'm going to work it from the y's. I could work it from the z's. I mean, these just added up, cancel out. But then I would have to do, like, this times 3 and this times 4, which I know some of you did. That's fine. It really does not matter. It's whatever you do, as long as you do it correctly, who cares? So I'm going to work it from the y's. And the only reason I'm doing that is because I see that these, they're just 1's. So if I multiply this by a 4, then I've got a positive 4 and a negative 4, and I've got a positive 4 and a negative 4. So I'm going to take row 1, and I'm going to add 4 times row 2. So row 1 is negative x plus 4y minus 4z equals 5. And row 2 times 4 is a negative 2x. I just messed up already. Okay, 4 times row 2. I gotta remember what I'm doing because I was thinking about something else. 4 times a negative 2 is a negative 8. Okay, negative 1 times 4 is a negative 4. 4 times 4 is 16. And 4 times negative 8 is negative 32. So I get a negative 1 plus a negative 8 is a negative 9x. The y's simplify out. Negative 4 plus 16 is 12. And negative 32 plus 5 is a negative 27. Which again, I notice I divide by 3 and I get negative 3x plus 4z equals a negative 9. That's a lot smaller equation to deal with. So if you, you know, anyway, if you can see it, then you can use it, and it makes your life easier. Okay. Now I'm going to do row 1 plus row 3 times 4. So basically the same thing. Row 1 plus 4 times row 3. So I'll write row 1 down, negative 1x plus 4y minus 4z equals 5. And I'm going to multiply row 3 by 4. So negative 16x. So negative 4 times 4. Negative 1 times 4 is negative 4. Negative 3 times 4 is a negative 12. And 16 times 4 is 60. So I add, and I get negative 17x minus 16z equals 65. Okay, these do not all divide by something, so we cannot do that. I'm actually going to go ahead and use the smaller equation, okay? So if you think about it, you can use it. So I've got a negative 3x plus 4z equals a negative 9, and I've got a negative 17x minus 16z equals 65. So, well, that makes it really easy. Because if I had done the original one, I had a 12 right here. I mean, 12 and 16 both go into... Actually, I gotta think about that for a minute. Now, who cares? I could multiply this by 16 and this by 12 and then cancel them out. I could multiply this by, if this is a negative 9, like it is up there, then I could multiply this by a negative 17 and this by a positive 9. But with it being 4 and 16, all I gotta do is multiply one of the equations by 4, which is super nice. Let's see. So if I were to multiply this equation by 4, negative 12x plus 16z equals a negative 36, and then just use this equation, then it's a lot easier. So anytime you think about, anytime you notice that every term divides by something, it's to your advantage to use that. So negative 12 plus a negative 17 is a negative 29. Those simplify out, and 65 minus 36 is, I think, 29. So x equals a negative 1 when you divide by negative 29. Okay. And then I go back to one of my equations to solve for z. I'm going to use this equation. So I use negative 3 times a negative 1 plus 4z equals a negative 9. And I get 3. So I subtract the 3 over and I get negative 12, and then I divide by 4 and I get negative 3. And then I've got z and I've got x. So I'll use, this time I'll use the middle equation. Negative 2 times x So negative 2x, x is negative 1, minus y, which is what I'm solving for, plus 4z equals negative 8. Now you can even see what I was writing. Okay. So this is 2. This is negative 12. 2 plus a negative 12 is negative 10. Negative y minus 10 equals a negative 8. So we add the 10 over. Negative y equals 2. And then y equals a negative 2 when you divide by negative. So my answer is again negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. Okay. That is number 16. I'm actually going to work number 20 now and call that good as far as process goes. So number 20. I've got negative 6x plus 8y plus 6z equals 7. I've got a negative 4x plus 12y plus 4z equals 13, and negative 8x plus 4y plus 4z equals a negative 1. Okay, something to think about. If you ever notice that every single term in your original problem is divisible by a number, you can divide that out. Like, if that had been a 12, I would totally would have divided out a 4. But it's not. Oh well. Okay. So, what do I want to eliminate? So I'll just talk through real quick my thought process. When I look at x's, I see if I multiply this by -4, I've got a +8. And then if I multiply this by 3 and this by -2, or this by 2 and this by -3, I've got 12s. I like y's actually because I see that 4 is a factor of both of those. So if I multiply this by -2, I get 8. And if I multiply it by -3, I get 12. And z's are kind of nice because if I just multiply one of these by negative, then they cancel out. But then I've got to multiply like this by 3 and this by -2 or this by 2 and this by -3 to get 12s and -12s or with the first and the third. But I like y's the most, so I'm going to go ahead and go with y's. I guess this time. Because I'll do it both. Okay. So, with y's, I am going to first do row 1 and row 3. So I'm going to add row 1 plus a -2 times row 3, so that I get a -8. So I've got -6x for row 1 plus 8y plus 6z equals 7. And -2 times row 3. So -2 times -8 is a +16. -2 times 4 is a -8. -2 times 4 is a -8. And -2 times -1 is a +2. Okay. And I add, and I'm left with 10x, -2z, and 9. Which doesn't simplify from there, so I just move on. Okay, now I'm going to use row 2 plus a -3 times, oops, plus a -3 times row 2. What am I saying? Times row 3. Okay, so I'm going to take row 2, and I'm going to multiply row 3 by a -3, so that becomes a -12. So I'm going to write down row 2, -4x plus 12y plus 4z equals 13. And then on row 3, I'm going to multiply by -3, so I've got a +24. Let's multiply by -3, so -12. -3, so -12. -3, so +3. I don't know what I'm saying. Showing you. -8 times a -3 is a +24. Four times a -3 is -12. Four times a -3 is -12. -1 times a -3 is +3. And then we add 24 minus 4, or -4 plus 24, same thing, is 20. 4 minus 12 is a -8. And 13 plus 3 is 16. Okay, so this is one of those situations where I noticed something. I noticed that they're all divisible by 4, so I could say 5x minus 2z equals 4, and I really like that, because I don't know if you notice this, but that's a 2, and that's a 2, and that makes it a lot easier. So I'm going to use it. Okay, so I'm going to write down 10x minus 2z equals 9, and then I'm going to write down 5x minus 2z equals 4. And I noticed that all I gotta do is change the signs on one and I can eliminate. So I'm gonna go ahead and change the signs on the bottom one. I'm just multiply by a negative. And then I've got 5x equals 5, which means x equals 1. Okay. Now if x equals 1, then I go back into one of my equations and I solve for z. So I'm gonna use the top equation. Just because 10 times 1 minus 2z equals 9. 10 times 1 is 10. So if I subtract 10, I'm left with a negative 1. And that means z equals a +1/2 when you divide negative 1 by negative 2. Now, normally I would say if you have a fraction that, you know, something's wrong. But like but this problem specifically I made to have fractional answers. So it's okay. All right. So z equals 1/2, x equals 1, and now I use the original equation, so I'm going to use the bottom one. So the bottom equation is -8x, which is 1, plus 4 times y, plus 4 times z, which is 1/2, equals a -1. So I've got -8 plus 4y, 4 times 1/2 is 4 times 1 divided by 2, which is 2, or 4 divided by 2, which is 2 times 1. Either way, I get 2. Negative 8 plus 2 is negative 6. Add the 6 over, and we get 5. And so y equals 5 over 4. Now, one thing I haven't been doing is going back and actually plugging them back into the original, any of the original equations, to see if they work. And that's like poor test-taking strategy on my own part. But it's definitely something you should think about doing. So if I were working this, if I were taking my test and I wanted to make sure that was correct, I would take 1/5 and negative or 1/2, and I would plug them in for x, y, and z, and see in any equation and see if I get like 13 or negative 1 or 7. If I do, then I'm correct. Okay? All right. So, I'm thinking that if you're still with me and you're working on this problem and you're about to watch the second half or the second way to do it, maybe you want to see if I do the same variable you do, maybe you deserve a little bonus. But if I do this and then every single person, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a little thing, and then if everyone shows up with it on their test, then I'm going to know that you just told everyone, in which case, no bonus. But this should only be for people that watch this part of the video. So if you watch this part of the video, when you're working this problem, if you put, let's go with, draw a little star and put a box around it. If you do that on your test, then I'll give you a 1-point bonus on this problem. Okay? So, don't tell everybody. Don't even talk to anybody about it. It should only be something that you know, and if you watch the video. So, a little bonus for watching the video. Okay. So, we're still doing this. Okay. I'm going to target a different variable. I'm going to target z's. Okay. So, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to use row 2 and row 3. I'm going to take row 2 and I'm going to multiply row 3 by a negative, so basically subtract row 3. So I'm going to multiply, or I'm just going to write down negative 4x plus 12y plus 4z equals 13. I'm going to multiply row 3 by a negative, so just change all the signs. Positive 8x minus 4y minus 4z equals a positive 1, and add. So I've got 4x plus 8y equals 14. Which they're all even, so if I wanted to, I could use 2x plus 4y equals 7. I might just do that. Okay. Now I'm going to cancel out z's again using row 1 and 3. I didn't use row 2 and row 3 because that's a 13 and that's just rude. So I'm going to use these two rows, okay? I'm going to multiply this top row by 2, so 1 by 2. And I'm going to multiply the bottom equation by a negative 3 so that I get a positive 12 here and a negative 12 there. And you could have switched the negative location, but whatever. I made kept this in positive, so the larger number would be positive. But anyway, okay, actually that'll be positive too now. So 2 times negative 6 is a negative 12x. 2 times 8 is 16y. 2 times 6 is 12z. And 2 times 7 is 14. Okay, negative 3 times row 3. Negative 3 times negative 8 is a positive 24. Negative 3 times a positive 4 is a negative 12. Negative 3 times a positive 4 is a negative 12. And negative 3 times negative 1 is positive 3. So I add, and I'm left with 12x plus 4y equals 17. Which definitely does not divide by something, but I don't need it to, because look, if I use this equation and this one, then all I gotta do is make one of them negative and the numbers are easy. If I use this equation and this one, so if I use these two, then I would just say, okay, let me multiply this by negative 2. But I'm gonna go ahead and do 2x plus 4y equals 7 and 12x plus 4y equals 17. And all I'm going to do is change the signs of one of them. So multiply, let's do the top row by negative 1. So I'm left with negative 2x minus 4y equals a negative 7. 12x plus 4y equals 17. Add 10x equals 10. X equals 1. I just did that out of the window. So multiply this by negative 2. So negative 2x, negative 4y, negative 7. And then 12x plus 4y equals 17. And then I simplified to 10x. Those canceled out to equals 10. Divided by 10 and got 1. Now, I've got x equals 1, so I'm going to go to one of my original equations. I'll go ahead and go to this one. Why not? So 12 times 1 plus 4y equals 17. So that's just 12. So I subtract 12, and I'm left with a 5. And so y equals 5 fourths. Okay. Now, if y equals 5 fourths, then I guess I could have shown you where I didn't solve for x again. That made it really easy both times because I got 1. If I had solved for x, if I had solved for y's by multiplying this by negative 6, then anyway, you would have seen the fraction work, but oh well, whatever. Okay. I've got x, I've got y. Let me use one of the original equations. I'll use the top one. Negative 6x, which is 1. Plus 8y, which is 5 over 4, plus 6z equals 7. So I'm using the top equation, number row 1. So I've got negative 6. 8 times 5 over 4, you can think 8 times 5 is 40, divided by 4 is 10. Or you can think 8 divided by 4 is 2, and 2 times 5 is 10. Either way, that's what we get. Negative 6 plus 10 is 4. So if I subtract 4, I'm left with a 3. And then if I divide by 6, I get 1 half, because 3 sixths is 1 half. Final answer, 1 5 fourths, 1 half. Always make sure it's in order. Okay. So, that's that. Let's move on to transformations. Now, I'm not going to, I'm not going to work all of this one. I'm going to work most of the other one, but I am going to work this right here. Just because I feel like you probably would benefit from that. So the original function looks like that. I'm going to take a second and plot that on my new graph. So just give me a second. So that's at negative 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's at negative 3, negative 1, and 1. And that's up there at 1, 2, 3. Okay. So there's my original picture. Okay. The first thing we need to do is talk about transformations in general. Okay. When you have transformations, or when they're, when you have different things going on, the only things I talk to you about are reflections and vertical and horizontal shifts. We're not talking about stretches and compressions until later. So I told you that these are the different things you could see. X plus or minus, it doesn't really matter. Who cares? Okay. So this is F of all of this. Okay. Normally you would think work from the very inside out, but if you have this and this at the same time, this should go first, this should go second, the flip should go, that flip should go third, and this should go fourth. Okay? So as a reminder, if I have a negative f of x, that literally means I take the function and if it was a parabola, if it was up here and now it's down here, okay? So I flip it over to the x. If you have a negative on the inside, say you have a function that looks like this, okay? It's taking all the x values and making them negative, or if it's taking all the negative x values and making them positive, so it's just flipping it over the y-axis, okay? If you have f of x plus 2, opposite on the inside that's shifting to the X's, not to the right 2, but actually to the left 2. And if you have minus, obviously that means go to the right. On the outside, you're shifting. It's like, this is the same thing as like saying Y notation, right? So if I add 2, that means I'm literally taking it and going up 2. And if I have like minus 3, then I'm going down 3. Okay? So keeping all this in mind, the order of transformations are the things that we're going to do. The first thing I should do is on the inside, this flip over the y-axis. Okay? Actually, I'm going to change the color on that because I want it to be lighter. The first thing I'm going to do is the flip over the y. And then I'm going to do the flip over the x. And then I'm going to do down 2. Now, if you're confident in your ability to do these transformations all in one time, then go ahead. It better be right, though, okay? Because wrong is wrong. The only thing you do is wrong. But if you do one step wrong and the other two correctly, then I can give you partial credit. Okay. So first I'm going to flip over the y, which means if... Oh, hello. Y. Okay. This is to the right 1, which means now it goes... Well, I'll start over here because that's easier to think about. This is over here at negative 5, so that means it should be over here at positive 5. This is at negative 3, so it should be a positive 3 for the x's, not the y's. This is at negative 1, so it should be a positive 1. This is positive 1, so it should be negative 1. So actually, my new equation looks like that. And it should look like a reflection across the y-axis. Okay. The next thing I'm going to do is flip over the x. So the flip over the x takes it and just the orange one now, or the second one I drew. I guess I could do that. Oh, that's the first. I've given. It's the first transformation. Now I'm going to flip it over the x. So it's up 4, so it's down 4. Up 4, down 4. Up 2, down 2. Up 5, down 5. And so I keep using dotted because I'm not to my final answer, and I don't want to get confused whenever I start answering questions. My final answer, that one's the second one, is I take it and move the whole thing down 2. And I connect that with solid. And this is my final answer. Okay, so the value of h of negative 1. All that's asking me is saying, like, when x equals negative 1, y equals what? Okay? So when x equals negative 1, my y value on my new equation is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, negative 6. So negative 6 is the answer to that. H of 3, 1, 2, 3. When x is 3, what's y? Negative 1, 2, 3, 4, negative 4. Okay? On what interval is h increasing? So if I look at the function, it is staying constant, increasing, and decreasing, right? So I drew these x values, or drew these dotted lines, because I don't care about what the y value, like how far it increases, I care about when is it increasing. So from x equals negative 1 until x equals 1, it's constant. From x equals 1 until x equals 3, it's increasing. So we say 1 to 3. Okay, what is the coordinate point of the absolute maximum? The absolute maximum is right here, the absolute highest the function goes. So that is the coordinate point 3, negative 4. Okay. Number 28. So number 28 asks about the domain of the function. The domain is how far left and right the function goes. And so the farthest left I go is negative 2, and the farthest to the right I go is positive 4. So my domain is negative 2 to positive 4, and we put brackets because we're actually including those numbers. On increasing and decreasing, we don't, because that means you're including it on like increasing and decreasing, which means you're doing the same, two different things at one time. And that's called no. Okay. On 29 asks, what's the range? The range is how low and how high the function goes. The lowest it goes on the y-axis is a negative 4, and the highest it goes is 0. So my range is negative 4 to 0. And these should always go low to high. If if you put 0 to negative 4, you're wrong. You're partially wrong. I'll give you partial credit, but it's got to go low to high number, okay? Okay. Oh, I gotta sneeze. And thank you if you just said, bless you. So, increasing. Okay. Down here. I see that my function starts here. And then it increases until there. And then the function decreases until there. And then the function increases until this x value. And then the function decreases until this x value. So I just need to figure out what those numbers are. This x value is negative 2. This x value is 0. This one's 2, 3, 4. So, I am increasing from negative 2 until 0. I am decreasing from 0 to 2. I am increasing from 2 to 3. And I am decreasing from 3 to 4. And we are never constant, so actually we need to say something there. Go ahead and put an A. It's not applicable. All right. Number 31 says, on what interval does f have a constant slope of 3 over 2? So my function is increasing. It's asking when do I have a slope of 3 over 2, which means I'm going up 3 and over 2. And this is constant slope because this curve right here has actually infinite many slopes, which is not something we really talk about until calculus. But this right here has just the same slope the entire time. Linear functions, that's all you know really about slopes. And it goes up 3 and over 2 to get from this point to that point. So it's on this interval, negative 2 to 0, that we have that slope. Okay. What would the absolute maximum value be if the function was reflected over the x-axis? Okay, so reflecting over the x-axis means whatever this is down here, it would flip over and be up there, right? So it kind of makes sense that the lowest value here would be the highest value up there. So since the function is at its lowest at negative 4, at negative 2, negative 4, the highest value would be positive 4 if I flipped it. So that's just a matter of thinking about the reflection. Now, some people actually drew the reflection, and I don't have any problem with that. But you don't have to. And so they say, okay, reflecting, the absolute max would be there, and it says the value, so it's positive 4. Okay, number 34. I'm going to take a second and draw the original. So there's my original function, and I have three different transformations acting on it. The first one on the interior means go to the right 3. Remember, opposite on the inside. The next one is this flip on the outside, and I'm going to flip over the x. And then the last one is this plus 3 on the outside, which means go up 3. So, first thing I'm going to do is go right 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. And there we go. Okay. Got kind of curvy there. Okay, so that is the first transformation. Then I'm going to do the second one, which is flip over the y. Sorry, over the x. So this is right here, this is right here, this is right here, and then this is there, and there. Can we see that before? Okay, so I flipped over the x-axis, so that is my second transformation, and then I'm going to go up 3. If your function goes off the graph, that means something is probably wrong, because I'm going to make it to where they don't go off the graph, hopefully. Watch me say that, and then next one with it. Okay. If it does go off the graph, I'll let you know, but it shouldn't on the test. So that is my final answer. What is the value of k of 1? So k of 1 is asking when x equals 1, what's the y value? The y value of my final answer is 7. It goes up 7. And when x equals 6, which is right here, the y value of my final answer is 3, because it goes up 3. Okay? On what interval is k decreasing? Well, interval or intervals, right? Okay, so I noticed right off the bat that... Okay, I'll go ahead and do it up here just because there's a lot going on down there. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So remember, on increasing and decreasing, we only use x values and we only use parentheses. So I noticed that from 1 to 3, the function is decreasing. From 3 to 5, the function is increasing. From 5 to 6, the function is decreasing and then increasing. So my answer is that it's decreasing from 1 to 3 and from 5 to 6. Okay, domain and range. The domain is how far left and right the function goes. I already can see that the function goes from 1 to 7. And my range is how low and how high the function goes. So the lowest it goes is 3 and the highest it goes is 7. So the range is 3 to 7. If you think about it like this way, it goes from 1 until 7. Left to right. And then it goes from 3 until 7 on the range. Okay. On what interval does the function have a slope of 1/2? So going to the final answer. This is down 3 and over 2. This is up 1 and over 2. So that is my interval, 3 to 5. Okay. Matrices. Okay. I say okay way too often. Matrix B, it says, what are the dimensions of matrix B? The dimensions of a matrix are determined by the rows and the columns. So I kind of, like, on this one, I would always do, like, row by column. So I would go 3 rows, 4 columns. I would just make that L. And this one, I go down 1 and over 4. So it is a 1 by 4. This location, it says, what entry is located at B1, 1? And that means the first row, first column. So first row, first column is 5, and the address of 1 is in the first row of the fourth column, so it's B1, 4. 38 says 2D minus 4I. So when you're adding and subtracting matrices, they have to have the exact same dimensions. D is a 2 by 2, I is a 2 by 2. So I can do this. Now, I'm going to go ahead and figure out what 2D is and what 4I is, and then I'm going to subtract. Okay, you can do it all at one time. In fact, that's why I didn't do it all at one time, but I could do it all at one time here. Whatever, okay. 2D is 18, negative 6, 0, and 4. So I just took every term in D and multiplied it by 2. And then I'm going to subtract 4 times I. So 4 times 0 is still 0. 4 times 1/2 is 4 times 1. 4 divided by 2 is 2. 4 times 1 is 4. And 4 times negative 7 is negative 28. And then I'm going to subtract. So basically 18 minus 0. Negative 6 minus 2 is a negative 6 minus 2 is a negative 8. 0 minus 4 is a negative 4, and 4 minus negative 28 is 4 plus 28, which is a 32. Okay. Is it feasible that you can do all of this in your head? Absolutely. I'm probably not going to give you a calculator. Some of the numbers on these problems on the review get kind of large. I will not make them large on the test if I do not give you a calculator. So you can do it in your head, that's fine, but like I said, wrong is wrong. So like, if I can't figure out what you did I can't see it, then I can't give you partial credit. But if you were doing this and you accidentally wrote a negative 24 here, well, then that would just be like minus 0.25 because you got everything else correct. And I could see what you did. And you did it consistently. But if you just have like a wrong answer here, then that's just like, you know, then you're only, I'm only grading this. And so that's just minus for that answer. And that's something to think about. Okay. All right. Number 40 says C3CE. Okay. So something to think about. When I multiply C times E, well, first off, I gotta see if I can. This is a 3 by 3. And E is a 3 by 2. And those are the same, so I can. And my dimensions, my answer is going to be a 3 by 2. Okay. So I can. And what I can think about is multiplying by 3. What I did over on the work on the board that I posted, I did C times E, and then I multiplied everything by 3. Something to think about. This right here. If I multiply everything by 3, it makes quite a bit of the number, a lot of the numbers large. But one thing it does do for you is it makes this fraction no longer a fraction, because 3 times 10 thirds is just 10. I don't know if it's worth it to make me have to multiply all those numbers by 3 and then add with that over there. So I'm gonna leave it as is. But that is something you could go ahead and do, is multiply 3 times one of the matrices and then multiply the matrices together. I'm going to go ahead and just do it this way, though. Honestly, though, when I'm doing matrices, I prefer to have them written down beside each other. So I'm going to write them down. So I'm supposed to do 3CE. So C is 5, 0, 10 thirds, negative 6, negative 4, negative 11, 3 fifths, 8, and 12. Times E, which is 5, 0, 1, 2, negative 4, 6. And I know that my answer is supposed to be a 3 by 2. So I'm going to go ahead and draw the space for a 3 by 2. So 3 rows, 2 columns. You do not have to show this part where you show all your work, but it's something about as a possibility. Okay. So when I multiply row by column, this is how we multiply, right? We multiply row by column. First row, first column, that should go here. So I'm going to multiply 5 times 5 plus a negative 6 times 0 plus 3 fifths times 1. So it's 5 times 5 plus this times this plus that times that. Okay? So let's go ahead and simplify that. It's 25 plus 3 fifths. That is, because the middle one's 0. Common denominator is 5, so I'm going to multiply top and bottom by 5. That's 125. So 125 plus 3 is 128 fifths. So that's that first answer. All right, next I have row, first row times second column, which puts me in the first row, second column, my answer. So 5 times 2, and if you just want to be writing down 10, that's fine. Negative 6 times negative 4, if you want to write down positive 24, again, that's cool. And then 3 fifths times 6. 3 fifths times 6. Okay. So I've got 10 plus 24, that's 34 plus 18 fifths. I think so. So I need a common denominator. The common denominator is 5, so multiply top and bottom by 5. 5 times 34 is 5 times 30, which is 150, plus 5 times 4 is 20, so 170. So 188 fifths. Okay. If you have to work out something on the paper, just do it. You know, no shame. It's not like I'm going to be upset with you when I see your work out here when you multiply 5 times 34. That's... you're doing the math. That's what I'm asking you to do. Okay, now I'm on the second row, so I need to multiply the second row times the first column. So I've got 0 times 5 plus negative 4 times 0 plus 8 times 1. Okay, and that is 0 plus 0 plus 8, so that's easy, that's 8. Next I've got second row times second column, which just means second row, second column. So 0 times 2, if you can write down 0, you can, plus a negative 4 times a negative 4, and plus 8 times 6. So I've got 0 plus 16 plus 48, so that is 48 plus 10 is 58, plus 6 is 64. All right, now I'm ready to do third row, first column. Third row times the first column, 10 thirds times 5, plus negative 11 times 0, plus 12 times 1. So I've got 10 thirds times 5, which is 50 thirds, plus 0, plus 12. So my common denominator is 3, so I multiply top and bottom by 3, that's 36, so that is 86 thirds. And then I need this last one, so third row, third column. So 10 thirds times 2, plus negative 11 times negative 4, plus 12 times 6. Ooh, those are big numbers, okay. So that is 20 thirds. That is 44 and 72. 44 plus 72 is 116. Yes. 76 plus 40. Yes. 116. Over 1, so the common denominator is 3. 3 times 116 is 348. Yes, 348. 348 plus 20 is 368. So 368 thirds. So like I said, I'm not gonna put, I'm not gonna make the numbers large on your test if I don't give you a calculator, so there you go. Oh, I'm not done. Woo, that would've been bad. Okay, I gotta multiply everything by 3. So, 3 times 128, 3 times 12 is 36, so 360 plus 3 times 8 is 24, so 384, 384 fifths, 3 times 188, 3 times 18, let's go 3 times, okay. Well, that's what I'm trying to say, like, if you need to, like, write it out, 3 times 8 is 24. 3 times 8 is 24, 25, 26, 3 times 1 is 3, 564. 3 times 8 is 24, 3 times 64 is 172, 192. 3 times 6 is 18, 3 times 4 is 12, so 192. 3 times 86 thirds is just 86, and 3 times 368 thirds is 368. I'm going to check real quick and make sure I was correct. Okay, somebody was there. Oh, good. Okay. I'm going to do one more. GH plus 1/4 J. I'm not going to do that, so. You need to, but I'm not going to. I've already done it. Once. All right, 41. I decided to put this on the review instead of 42 because I figure this has a little bit more going on. Although, HI is more interesting, but oh well. Okay, so I'm supposed to do GH plus 1/4 J. GH plus 1/4 J. This is number 41. 2h plus 1/4 j. G is this one and this one. I'm going to write it down. 4, negative 3, 0, 7. H is 5, negative 4, 9, 0. 8, 6, negative 1, 7. So GH plus 1/4 times J. Oh, I made that really huge. 4, negative 6. Damn it, Jennifer. 1/4, negative 6, 12. That's fine. Oh, I wrote them really close together. Okay, so when I multiply a 1 by 4, 1 row, 4 columns, by a 4 by 2, then I get a 1 by 2, which is really kind of nice. I have 1 row, 2 columns. Okay, 1 row, 2 columns. And the only reason... Okay, I know to make my line long, because I'm going to show them the work, but because I have 4 terms times 4 terms, so that's why I draw it long, as opposed to just being like, there you go. Okay, so first row, first column, so 4 times 5 is 20, negative 3 times negative 4 is 12, 0 times 9 is 0, and 7 times 0 is 0, and so I've actually just got a 32. And then, first row times second column. 4 times 8 is 32. Negative 3 times 6 is negative 18. 0 times negative 1 is 0. And 7 times 7 is 49. So, 49 minus 18 is 31. And 31 plus 32 is 63. And then we need to do 1/4. Of J, so 1/4 times negative 6 is a negative 6 divided by 4, which is a negative 3 over 2. And 1/4 of 12 is 3. So let's add. I've got 32 plus a negative 3 halves and 63 plus 3. So that's 69, Jennifer. 66 and multiply by 2. So I get, oh, I'm not even seeing what I'm doing. I added 63 and 3 and got a 69. Okay, so crap like that happens, but, because I was thinking 3 times 3. But it's 66. And then 32 minus 3 halves, the common denominator is 2. So 2 times 32 is 64. 64 minus 3 is 61. So 61 halves. And that is my final answer. Okay. Hope this helps.